gets one to drive and makes the most of it.
It's gone for the hooks in the air. Hooper's taken it, a second slip. Darryl Hare says not out. He clearly saw that it didn't make contact with the glove, and once again the umpires consult about the light. Let's have another look at this one, Ian.
It's banged in, short and straight. And that is an absolutely magnificent decision. There's a fine decision that's come off the forearm.
And the umpires say that that's enough for today.
And there's the England card. Atherton and Stewart put on 129 for the first wicket, easily the highest partnership of the game. Hussain's delivery was unplayable, and Thorpe and Butcher have calmed the nerves by putting on a gritty 19. West Indies bowling, lion-hearted performances by Walsh and Ambrose, who'll be fresh for a final burst in the morning with a new ball only 5 overs old. And that's what England have to sleep on tonight. 38 more runs to win with 6 wickets in hand. Trinidad jinx hit England again yesterday, but it wasn't a West Indian fast bowler doing the damage, instead it was the weather. In total, the England batsmen were taken off 3 times for rain, and at the end, Graham Thorpe and Mark Butcher were left a tantalising 38 runs short of their target. They added 19 hard-fought runs in the gathering gloom, and today will hope to lead England to a memorable victory. Hello and welcome to the highlights of the 5th and final day of this enthralling test match, which once again had us on the edge of our seats yesterday. Well, after 30 wickets fell on the first 3 days, I don't think any of us thought we'd be here today. But yesterday at around tea time, it absolutely threw it down with rain, the last thing we were expecting, quite frankly, and 2 hours' play was lost. So this morning, we're keeping our eye very much on that patch of sky behind the scoreboard. Locals say if it's going to rain, it'll come from there. And I must admit, at the moment, it looks rather gloomy, doesn't it? Well, there's a state of play. England need only 38 more runs to win with 6 wickets in hand, and credit for that must go to Mike Atherton and Alex Stewart, who put on 129 for the first wicket yesterday. Well, although an England victory must be the most likely outcome today, regular viewers will know that literally anything can happen here in Trinidad. Courtney Walsh and Kirtley Ambrose will be fired up for one final fling, and they're using a new ball which is only 5 overs old. So will West Indies grab an unlikely victory, or will England cruise to their target? I'm sure Michael Holding has all the answers.
Well, England have got to be odds-on favourites to win this game this morning. It's the 5th day and you expect a bit of deterioration again in the pitch, but only 38 runs to get. If we take a look at the surface, you'll still see quite a few unattractive areas here. These areas just outside the off-stump, bowling towards the Queen's Park Pavilion end, the cracks there, they are crumbling, a few loose areas within the cracks. And this area, the ball has been pitching in quite often, and a few have been taking off, and a few have been keeping low. If the West Indies are going to win this game, they'll certainly need a few more deliveries, like the one that Carl Hooper bowled to Nassau Hussain that got that wicket. If they don't have deliveries like that, if they don't have a lot of luck, England should continue and win this game.
Thank you, Michael. Well, as we expected, it rained and held up play for 45 minutes, during which time we spoke to the umpire, Darryl Hare.
The ground staff told me that the forecast was just for showers clearing after lunchtime. The pitch and surrounds are quite good and the covers seem to do their job. Yesterday, just beside the pitch there appeared to be some very boggy patches when the rain finished, but by the time they cleared it up, the covers up, it was fine. So it obviously, you know, can take a fair bit of water in the outfield and surrounds.
Well, some positive news from Mr. Hare. Play was held up for 45 minutes and we joined the action in the first over after that. Ambrose bowling to Butcher, and one run has been added to the total.
Ball's got a pitch in line, Kirtley.
They have to realise, mate, this that it's going to be pretty difficult to get an LBW decision with the ball pitching outside the line of leg stump. It should be impossible. It's never ever impossible in this game, but it should be. Umpire should never ever give it out, although we do see mistakes being made.
There'll be two here for Butcher. England will see that as a very good first over for them. They've reduced the runs required by three. So applause for England's efforts, but vocal support for the West Indies. This gentleman demanding a wicket from Amby. That's Kirtley Ambrose.
We want help, Keller! Let's go, Ambrose! Yes, Keller!
Ambrose to Butcher. Runs here for England. Walsh can't get there. It's four leg byes.
Just slightly off target with this one, Kirtley Ambrose. Again, the ball pitching outside the line of leg stump. Certainly would have carried on to the stumps, but not the, quite the right line. Well, however they come, England will welcome them. He's disgusted with that, Kirtley Ambrose. He knows what he has done wrong.
A louder appeal from Ambrose.
Same problem again. Pitching just outside leg stump. Would have carried on and hit the stumps, but he's left-handed.
Useful 28 in the first innings and now 11 not out. It's a very good run. Thorpe was out of the blocks very quickly.
This is good running. Both of them really hustling. That's Graham Thorpe going to the wicketkeeper's end. Had a bit of a head start, but still had to hustle.
No stroke played. Thorpe's gone for it this time. Picked his fielder well. Kenny Benjamin can't stop the single. England's runs required now in the 20s.
With Brian Lara coming into that mid-off position, it always leaves a fast bowler somewhere in the covers. It was Nixon McLean in the previous over, now it's Kenny Benjamin.
Big shout this time.
And the Nichols coming under quite a bit of pressure here again with these LBW shouts. That hit him in line with the stumps, but again, pitching just outside the line of leg. That is the problem with these deliveries. Again, pitching just outside leg and going across the batsman. It's pretty difficult to get an LBW that way, pushing the ball across the left-hander. You've got to pitch it in line and get it straightened.
Yep. Flicked away by Butcher. He'll come charging back for the second. And he's made it. 27 required. Campbell's very quick. There'll only be one. Great work by Sherwin Campbell. Just about the fittest man in this West Indies side. Thorpe's getting back for the second.
Loud cheers again for a couple of runs. They know they are creeping close to the England supporters.
Those two runs brought up the 200 for England, 201 for four, 225 the target. Still some threatening weather around. Williams has got him. Ambrose gets the breakthrough, and it's Thorpe who's gone. Thorpe dismissed for 19. England aren't home yet. They're now five down for 201, and tantalisingly 24 runs still needed.
Well, Kurt Ambrose switching the line. Immediately that ball pitching in line with the stumps, going across to the body of the left-hander. He has to play. Gets the outside edge, and David Williams does a very good job. Graham Thorpe falls for 19. It's 201 for five.
Another left-hander comes in to join Mark Butcher. It's Jack Russell. England's wicket-keeping all-rounder.
A bunch of nervous English supporters. I can tell you that those two gentlemen have flown over just for this game. In the air, got away with it. Moments like that are mighty important. I bumped into Courtney Walsh in the lift, and he said things weren't going his way so far in this series. He mightn't be wrong.
Well, that's one of the few balls I've seen get quite big. And not only did it get quite big, it got quite big at pace, which is something that we haven't seen a lot of.
Well, Walsh got very excited there, but he must know that that's pitched well outside leg stump.
Well, I mean, Jack Russell hops around a bit, but this has got a pitch at least 6 inches, 9 inches outside leg stump. So it's all very well, it's going to hit the stumps, yes, but the rules state quite clearly that if the ball pitches outside leg, you cannot be a judged LBW. Darrell Hare having nothing to do with it.
One cloud is coming from the area that Michael Holding, our resident weatherman, seems to think is the dodgy spot. He's leaping about the place, giving us reports just in front of me here. Good bit of timing from Russell, and it'll get him two. Just a little nudge into the leg side. Gets the target down to 18. What we have now, though, is rain. Now, the ground staff are concerned. You can tell just by the fact that they've dressed fully up in the yellow oilies. Actually, it would be a shame for everybody if they came off now. Russell is pushing hard for the second, but Walsh has done well for a man with a dodgy throwing arm. That underarm flick has worked nicely for him.
I think the umpires have made the right decision here. And the sun is out there. There's still a little bit of rain in the air. And that has gone, luckily, that's gone round the back. It's what's coming from the right of that picture. And that looks a lot more promising. There's a bit of sunshine out there.
In the air. Question is, did it carry? Now, Stuart Williams caught it, had a little jog in. And then I think as he began to jog, he thought, no, I've got to be honest, I did not catch that ball.
It seems to be a tennis ball bounce, and Jack Russell was trying to leave it. And Stuart Williams, his reaction, tremendous. And then he realises that I've taken that on the half volley.
Courtney Walsh. Again now to Mark Butcher. Dead. Missed. Might have gone if he'd hit. And Jack Russell's just got to calm down a bit. He'll get Mark Butcher frantic. It's unnecessary.
It's all very well. Jack getting himself going, Jack Russell, but what he mustn't do is get his teammates dragging them all over the place. Mark Butcher would have been out if that had hit. And that would have been totally unnecessary.
also pitched outside leg stump. I think we must make the point. You know, it was a bit like John Crawley's run out yesterday, Ian. You know, when you're chasing a low score, a run out, a risky run, is immaterial. It's just, you know, they're going to burn enough good balls that might get you out without adding run outs into the equation. Benefit of a good line. We see it time and time again.
Yeah, that's a terrific delivery. I'm a little surprised it took Ketley Ambrose as long to come round the wicket this morning.
I'm sure Kirtley enjoyed that.
Well, if you're going to flash, flash hard. He gets the edge. Make it as difficult as possible. And the bounce there that Ketley Ambrose gets in the carry. Tremendous performer, isn't he?
Yeah, come on, yeah. It's worth two more. Even the merest nudge is getting raucous applause.
There's many a run scored in the grandstand.
Well, there's a new job for the England captain. Michael Atherton down there, acting as the site board attendant. Yes. Now what's that fallen over? Something's come out, gloves come off. I've never seen that one before. But of course, being Jack Russell, you'd have to pick him for it to happen to.
It's very idiosyncratic with his equipment, Jack Russell, but not the newest pair of gloves either, those. Not quite sure how that's happened.
They'll have to, there's yes, no, yes, no, yes, no. And in the end, very lucky to get in. Chanderpaul, perhaps the fastest and the best fielder on the West Indies side, was onto it.
Russell played this shot almost on the run, as though he knew where he was going to put the ball, then set off, then stopped. And Butcher, meanwhile, had scampered. Here he goes. Now there's the stop. And, thankfully for England, both men are in. Butcher a bit hesitant.
Would have been out had the ball hit the stumps. Hooper takes a catch. England are six down. It isn't over yet.
Good bowling from Ambrose. He targeted Russell round the wicket for the last couple of overs and finally got his reward. Good catch by Hooper as well. That, didn't get up much.
New batsman is Andy Carrick. So now the slips come in. Three of them now, and a short leg for Carrick. Pressure is told, they've got two wickets, now they're into the tail. Edged it, first ball. Ambrose strikes, not for the first time in this match, with wickets for successive balls. 213 for seven, three wickets to go, 12 runs to win.
Searing delivery from Ambrose, really running in, banged in short, got the bounce, got the edge, and got the catch. Great stuff from Ambrose. Carrick's gone for naught. England 213 for seven.
And Mark Butcher now has enormous responsibility on his shoulders. So does Dean Headley coming in now.
Big moment this for Dean Headley. came good with the ball in the second innings for England. Now can he come good with the bat? Survives the hat-trick ball.
Attention is showing all around, off the field as well as on it. Ambrose now comes around the wicket, remembering how he got Headley in the previous test match. Caught behind, delivering round the wicket. He'll try the tactic again. 12 required for England. Now 11. And they'll come back. They'll have to hurry, and they do. Frantic running. Down to 10 now.
Nerve jangling stuff here. Lara at mid on. And Butcher on strike and under enormous pressure. Walsh the bowler.
That's close. Umpire here reckons it's not close enough.
Well, that was close. It was a huge appeal by Walsh and Williams. Point of contact is outside, off stump. It's very much a run-saving field, this, when Lara needs wickets. It's a brute of a ball from Walsh. Bouncing and nipping back. Butcher just allowing it to hit him. Can't bear to look, Michael Atherton.
Just the one, 9 to go. And it does bring Mark Butcher into the strike now.
Oh, that's a big appeal. But it's going down, bowl from wide on the crease. Well, I think he might have got an inside edge on it. Well, pad first. Well, bit of a nervous laugh, I'm sure.
Still, it's one of the few occasions I've seen somebody bite his fingernails while smiling. Very good running between the wickets. It means also that Mark Butcher will have the strike, with England requiring another 7 runs to win the match and just 3 wickets remaining. Yes!
And just 1 run, 6 needed.
Well, England will be looking for every possible run. I think Dean Headley has shown that he is capable of defending.
That's a good stroke from Headley. A sensible stroke. He didn't try to hit it too hard, and he'll get 3 for it.
Well, I don't think Dean Headley would have made 3 more important runs in his entire career.
Very close. Very, very close indeed.
This is good bowling by Courtney Walsh. Well pitched up coming in towards Butcher, and I'm not too sure why that isn't out. That is very much on line above stump.
Very well run. Very well run. Headley's quick, and he was going to the danger end, but he'd started on the back foot, having played the defensive stroke. He just ups it a bit halfway down when he sees that there's a chance with Campbell. Butcher made the call.
Come on. Come on. No ball called. The scores are level. The West Indies can no longer win the match courtesy of that no ball. They could still tie it.
And to think that Eddie Nichols has called a no ball at this stage, well, a lot of West Indians would be saying, why has he called a no ball here? It's simply because it is a no ball.
One needed for victory, Curtly Ambrose to Mark Butcher. England have won it. England have won it. A margin of 3 wickets. How's that for a smile? Mark Butcher is the hero, but West Indies have heroes too. Brian Lara is one of them. Ambrose and Walsh are the others. The series is level at 1-1. You can see Alex Stewart up there. He's the hero of England's batting in this game for me. Dean Headley has shown a calm head under pressure. An impressive match with the ball this time round as well. 4 wickets in the second innings. He's unbeaten with 7 here and 11 nerve-jangling deliveries faced. The West Indies can hold their heads high. They've contributed to a fine occasion. There is no disgrace in losing this match. Admittedly, with some level of anti-climax, nothing David Williams could do, Michael.
Not really. That ball was so up post up, carried through wonderful to him. It was a bouncer, banged in pretty short by Curtly Ambrose. But again, we see the pitch not really offering consistent pace or bounce. David Williams definitely struggling. And elation for England. Mark Butcher really fought hard for this victory. Dean Headley started to celebrate long before he got to the other end. He knew it was over.
And that picture says it all. I've never known a test match like it, and the tension in that dressing room must have been quite unbearable. Angus Fraser has had the most amazing series, 9 for 80 in this match, 20 wickets at an average of 9 in all, and he was the man of the match. And that's how England got there, their highest ever total to beat the West Indies batting in the 4th innings. Butcher had an excellent game. He and Thorpe put on 33. A flutter before lunch with Russell and Caddick out with consecutive balls, but Headley and Butcher saw them home in the end. What a Herculean effort by Walsh and Ambrose. Only they bowled today, and Ambrose in particular kept West Indies in the hunt. And there's the result. The series now level. Well, what a remarkable game. The Trinidad jinx has finally been broken and the series is perfectly set up now, all square, with 3 matches still to be played. Well, we'll meet again in Georgetown, Guyana, a week on Friday for the start of the 4th Test match. But before I go, I'll leave you with some memories of this wonderful Test match, as if we could ever forget it. Good night. Oh.